I'm happy to be talking here about the links between science and action, because I think a lot about how science and engineering tools can be brought to bear on decision making. How can we inform the policy sphere? And here I'm going to be bringing the discussions that we had during the morning and so far in the action session to really think about the policies that might be on the table and how we can assess the potential benefits of those policies, how we can potentially choose between those policies. So a lot of people have mentioned the Paris Agreement, which was finalized last December at COP21. One of the characteristics of the Paris Agreement is that it really relies on countries to choose their own types of ways that they are going to reduce carbon. So I'm giving two examples here. The US Clean Power Plan, which proposes to reduce CO2 32% by 2030 from power plants, along with other aspects of a portfolio of approaches to meet the US commitment under this treaty. China is, as Valerie Karpus talked about earlier, talking about pricing carbon and using that as a program to limit emissions. So in terms of motivating action, a lot of the presentations this morning had x-axes on graphs that went out to 2050 and 2100. And a lot of the lifetimes of these policies is very short. So how do we keep up the motivation? How do we think about what will motivate countries and domestic policies as we move forward? And one of the major ways of doing that is to think about policies that benefit air quality. So air quality is a really substantial and near-term challenge. There have been a number of studies that talk about the number of health impacts that air quality has. Between 3 and 7 million deaths every year have been attributed to degraded air quality, depending on how you count and whether you count both outdoor and indoor air quality. Air quality and climate are really inherently linked because the pollutants that are emitted come from the same sources. So the same sources that are emitting carbon dioxide, cars, power plants, are also contributing to degrading our air quality. So thinking about as policymakers weigh climate benefits, as well as what they have to do with the economy, air quality is potentially a real motivator for action that links climate change to very near-term concerns. So using this as a case, I'm asking the question, how can we better inform policy design? And so I'm going to give you three examples of recent research from my group that assesses the local benefits of proposed climate policies. In the first one, I'm going to look at US carbon policies and how they can reduce emissions that contribute to local air pollutions here. In the second example, I'm going to look at the scientific link between air quality and climate and how improved climate can actually lead to air pollution benefits, so the other way around. And then the third, I'll give you an example on toxic air pollution in which carbon policies can reduce mercury pollution in both China and India. So starting with the first, thinking about choosing carbon policies in the US. The Clean Power Plan reduces 30% of the carbon from the electricity sector. That's about 10% of CO2 between the years 2006 and 2030 economy-wide. It's not a lot of carbon. We need a lot more, but it's a place to start. So if you're thinking about cutting that much carbon, you can think about doing that in a couple of different ways. You could set a price on carbon, a cap and trade approach, and just let the economy decide where that carbon reduction is coming from. You can choose, as the Obama administration has chosen, to really focus on the energy sector. So looking at power plants, trying to get that carbon out of power plants. You can also look at the transportation sector, cars, trucks. You can ask the question, which policy is going to benefit air pollution and mitigate its health damages the most? And we worked with some air pollution regulators in the Northeast US to design these scenarios, and they're thought was that, well, energy and transportation, those are sources we know are fairly dirty. Our hypothesis is that that's going to actually have a bigger impact on air pollution controlling those sources than if you let the economy decide. Then we don't know where that CO2 is going to come from. So we asked, well, let's actually look at that. Let's see what happens. And so we used, as a method, an integrated modeling approach, linking some economic models, like the models that Valerie described, with air pollution models, and then health impact assessment to really pull this all together to see what the impacts of these different policy choices would be on the atmosphere and then on people. So this is the first step of the results. This is what emissions are associated. So all of these policies, you'll remember, have the same effect on greenhouse gas emissions, on CO2. But the precursors to the pollutants we care about in the atmosphere, and those pollutants are ozone and fine particulate matter, or PM2.5, particles that are small enough to be inhaled and breathed deep into the lungs. Sulfur dioxide is a big precursor to particulate matter. That comes a lot from power plants. The Clean Energy Standard has a big effect on reducing sulfur dioxide. Nitrogen oxides and carbon monoxide are precursors to ozone. Nitrogen oxides are also precursors to particulate matter. Those come from cars and trucks. The transportation scenario has a big effect on those. Cap and trade attacks both. It just looks for the most economically efficient, and in some cases, those are power plants. In some cases, those are cars and trucks. We can then look at the formation of these secondary pollutants, ozone and particulate matter, in the atmosphere with modeling, atmospheric chemical modeling. And what we see, the bottom row here is the particulate matter, the top row here is the ozone, clean energy on the left, transportation, and then cap and trade. And it looks pretty similar. There are widespread decreases in pollution when you cap carbon across the United States. Now, there are some differences. Transportation in some of the urban areas in the eastern US. But on broad scale, these are decreases in pollution. Again, it looks a lot more similar than this picture. And that's because all of these chemicals are interacting in the atmosphere. So how do we pull that together to where we can inform policymakers? So policymakers really react well to thinking about money, thinking about the economy. So what we can do is we can calculate how many mortalities are likely to be avoided from these changes in air pollution. And we can use associations, epidemiological associations, between pollution and mortality to do that. And we can use standard regulatory methods to figure out the economic benefit that would be associated with this. And we get a picture that looks somewhat like this. We have several different scenarios, and these are different uncertainty scenarios on how the policy is implemented. In the blue here are cap and trade. In the green, our clean energy standard. In the red, the transportation scenario. Here on the x-axis is how expensive the policy is. And on the y-axis, here's just the benefits in a monetized sense to human health that you get when you implement these policies. The important thing about this is actually on the same scale. This is a one-to-one line. So even just taking into account the ozone and particulate matter related so-called co-benefits for health, for these cap and trade and clean energy standards, in a lot of cases, you're more than exceeding the cost of the policy. And if you look, actually that a priori assumption that the regulators had that there's a big difference in the health co-benefits between these different scenarios wasn't necessarily the case. What was the case is that these scenarios were very different in terms of cost. So thinking about what kinds of costs you want to impose relative to the benefits, this provides some information on the range of those potential benefits. So it really shows that for a wide variety of types of carbon policies in the US, these have substantial benefits just to human health alone. Now, this is a strong motivator for action, but the question is how much does it motivate action? And in this graph, we showed this is this 10% cut, the 10% reduction from 2006 emission level, and this is the policy costs that you can cover by co-benefits. So in some of these scenarios, we're up to 1,000% of policy costs. If you then ratchet that down, you get to 20%. We did one scenario, and that drops way down. And this is because a lot of those mortalities are coming from coal. Remember the graph that Dennis White showed? The left side of that graph were coal. When you got down to gas, which was the next technology over there, it dropped substantially. The difference between gas and wind, solar, and nuclear was much smaller. That's basically what's happening here. We need to get to about here, maybe up to 100 in terms of being consistent with a 2-degree target. So while this is a strong motivation now, it might not hold in the future. So moving on to the second area is, well, okay, what about these climate-related benefits? Because we're not assessing those at all in this study. We're just looking at what you happen to get for free if you do climate policy. And this is a study that we did thinking about the impacts of climate change on air quality. Now, Dan Sitso this morning talked about the influence of aerosols on the climate. Now, what I'm talking about is the influence of climate on air pollution. Now, you can think about this in your own experience. On hotter days, on days that it's less windy, you might experience more air pollution. Well, this happens locally, but it will happen more often in the future climate. We call this the climate penalty on air quality. It means that if we have the same emissions, air quality might be degraded even just by the changes we might experience in the climate. So I'm looking at two scenarios here. This is the US temperature change under a reference scenario. This is under a policy scenario. And you can see that the warming is much greater under the reference scenario. This is going to have an effect on air quality. How do we think about those benefits? Well, we did a series of simulations to quantify that. And what we see is that this is for ozone and particulate matter. As we move from the present day to 2100, we see under the reference case increases in both ozone and particulate matter as a result of these climate changes. In our policy cases, we see that that difference is mitigated. In both policy cases, which are more stringent controls on carbon. So we can do something similar that we did before, thinking about the economic benefits and talking about what portion of the costs these benefits cover. And we get something like potentially up to 15% of the cost. Again, this isn't looking at co-benefits. This isn't looking at sort of any other sector. This is just the air quality sector. And we get on the order of tens of thousands, maybe about 50,000 avoided deaths by mitigating climate change. So we can start thinking about this as motivation for policy decision making. And this study was actually included in an EPA report called the Climate Change Impacts and Risk Analysis Report, for which air quality was only one of a number of sectors of different infrastructures and water, for example, that were quantified in terms of the benefits to the US for climate action. So finally, in my third study, I'm looking at controlling carbon and its impacts on toxic air pollutants. So mercury is a toxic air pollutant that comes from coal. And in this study, we looked at what implications would different end of pipe controls on mercury. So this is where you put a technology on a coal power plant have on mercury emissions from China and India out to 2050. And as you ratchet up the stringency of those end of pipe controls, you get less and less mercury emissions. But if you had a climate policy that transforms the energy sector to be less reliant on coal, you get dramatically less mercury in all of the different control scenarios. So again, we can see how climate policy can have benefits across different sectors. And this is relevant to another international environmental treaty, the Minamata Convention, which was agreed in 2013. So to wrap up, these are real-world policy challenges. And thinking about how science can inform them really can give the on-the-ground decision-making when you're deciding which sector you're going to go after first, what the potential benefits are, how do you keep up the momentum. And a lot of these cases, they're decisions that will come into the court system and will think about costs and benefits and how they interact. So my research is really hoping to inform these debates by linking some of the decision making through scientific analysis to help us understand what we can see, expect to see on the ground. So with that, I'll acknowledge my team and take questions. Thanks.
We have time for a few questions.
In transportation, we may see a huge rollout of self-driving cars in the next decade or so. How will this affect your transportation, related to pollution, and so
The question is how self-driving cars would affect our transportation emission scenarios. It's interesting. You know, our ability to assess how technologies evolve in the future is limited in these sorts of economic models. And some of the uncertainty scenarios we did had to do with how we understand the rapid take-up of technologies. I haven't thought about self-driving cars particularly, but the more those technologies are available, the cheaper that these transformations will be.
Have you considered the possibility that reducing aerosol emissions could actually accelerate the warming rate to have a negative side effect, making air cleaner and healthier for us?
So the question is, have we considered the possibility that reducing aerosol emissions could have a negative side effect by reducing the cooling rate? And that's taken into account in the climate models, which project future climate. In general, we're looking at reducing aerosols for a substantial reason, which is the health benefits. But again, this unmasking of warming of the greenhouse gas warming that has been masked by aerosols is a substantial contributor to the evolution of climate out into the future. So yeah, that's something that that a variety of studies have looked at.
When you were looking at the different policies, were you looking at the risk of that policy actually creating the result that you were modeling? For example, an emission standard is fairly clear cut. You put in emissions saying you go get that reduction. Cap and trade, you're setting up a game with rules in it, and the players in that game are motivated by profit, not by carbon reduction. And so they may figure out lots of different ways of playing that game that don't give you the carbon reduction that you may have thought you were going to get out of that system. Have you looked at those uncertainties in the different policies?
So the question really is about policy uncertainty, that you set a policy and that you may not get the intended effect, particularly in areas of cap and trade or regulation. And that is a big issue. And we see that actually both in the cap and trade system and in regulatory implementation as well. Look at the recent Volkswagen scandal, for example, where you have a regulation and it's not necessarily fulfilled. So in this policy design, we simulated policies that were actually achieved, but that is a real-world consideration as well.
Is there one more question? Yep.
So your talk suggests that in the near term, you get very gigantic benefits from local air quality improvements. And I would guess in countries like China, maybe India, as well as the United States, that might be the real main driver in the next decade. But then if we look at the longer term climate problem, it looks like you run out of that advantage and you get more into things that just seem to be pure cost. And maybe you could comment on that.
So yeah, the question was how quickly do you run out of these opportunities for co-benefits on air quality? And you're right that there is a difference between the US and China. We do see We were surprised to see those near-term benefits in the US given the level of air quality regulations we have. The work we've done in collaboration with Valerie's group shows that those benefits are definitely longer lasting in China. We can continually see more of those co-benefits. With the longer term, as you get down to sort of 80% cuts, this is where the climate benefit is going to be really important to assess.